And he joins us now on the show. Alex, Michael, Don, and Peter, how are you?
What's up, guys? How are you? You guys are busy today.
Very, very busy. Let me ask you this, the Astros stuff. I'm sure you know about it. You love baseball. Alex, how prevalent is this in baseball? Did it happen when you played? Does this surprise you?
I've never heard of this type of stuff, Michael, and just in fairness, I just don't have enough information
right to
go really deep. But look, we are in 2019 going to 2020. There's so much technology, cameras. I think just you always have to hedge and play defense. I would always encourage our catchers to have multiple signs, whether there's a man on second or nobody on. You have to pretend that somebody is always trying, Big Brother's always watching, and you have to be careful with that.
So if you were a team that was victimized by the Astros cheating, A-Rod, would you look at it and say, that's a bad job, they cheated? Or would you look at it and say, we have to do a better job picking up on that? We should have educated ourselves and not allowed ourselves to be taken advantage of.
Well, Don, that's a great question. First of all, it's undefendable. If you're using cameras,
right.
And again, I'm not sure what Mike's position is, and I'm not sure the Astros, so I'm just speaking broadly speaking. There's some things that are undefendable. If you're wiring tap somebody's locker room or the other manager, there's stuff that you just cannot defend against. And if there's a center field camera that can pick up and slow down what signs are being given, any of that stuff, to me, that's on the, not kosher side.
Do you ever remember hearing of anything like, we heard yesterday, that people are like clanking trash cans together to make a noise. Do you recall ever hearing anything like that during your career, people doing something that egregious?
You hear everything. I played almost gone for 25 years, but you hear people with binoculars, you hear people with towels up in the bullpen, towels down. But when you bring in technology, I know we heard the Apple Watch a few years ago, but when you have a center field camera that's kind of zoomed in and you can slow down and you can repeat, and then that's just a whole different level of crossing the line. If somebody did that, that's obviously a big time issue, not only for the game, but for the credibility of the game.
I'm curious what you feel about this, because I used to talk to Bobby Mercer about it and Paul O'Neill as well. Let's say the legal stealing of signs, where a guy at second is giving you this, they didn't want a sign. Did you want a sign as a player if they picked up what was going to be thrown?
Look, first of all, anything human is fair game, right?
Right.
As a human being, looking into a catcher 160, 70 feet away, he's doing really fast signs. At the old stadiums, you could not see the signs because of the dimensions and the darkness. In the new stadium, obviously, the lights were a lot more clear. It depends, Michael. If it was you giving me the signs a second, probably not. But if it was a guy like John Olerud or somebody that I really trusted, remember John Olerud comes from the Blue Jays. And the Blue Jays, going back to Molitor and Roberto Alomar and D'Mon White, they were outstanding. So it depends on who was out there.
Could you steal signs? Were you good at it?
I was, because I was a shortstop coming up, so I was trained to look at signs and let the third baseman know what was coming. And Jeter would do it for me at third base. From a defense, it was important to really know what's coming, so you can actually predict the outcome of where the ball is going to be hit. But those are nuances that are so inside the game. Again, anything human is fair game. I think anything that you bring in technology and stuff like that, that's a whole nother level.
Was Boone disrespected by the Riders not getting the American League Manager of the Year?
It's a no-win situation. I think Aaron Boone deserved definitely to win the award. But then again, so did Rocco Baldelli. And look, we're New York. I think there is a negative bias that works against markets like New York, because we are the best franchise, we have the best resources, and you're supposed to win 100 games innately, but you had over 35 players going to IL, and they never missed a beat. I think Aaron Boone deserves, if not to be manager of the year, definitely, he lost, so what can I say?
Now, we had on Brian earlier, Brian Cashman, and he's talking about how he's investigated Cole and Strasburg. He's talked to Boris's people, all that. You were there every single game. Do they need a big-time starting pitcher? Because I look at it and say they lost because they didn't hit.
Michael, if you don't have dominant starting pitching, you're not going to win. You can dress code it as much as you want, but it all starts with pitching. It ends with pitching. The New York Yankees have 27 World Championships. They are the epitome, the gold standard of starting pitching, and there's no way around it. The only team that's won without dominant pitching over the last 20 years is
the Royals.
Kansas City Royals.
Yeah.
And that's it.
But if I'm going to be in the postseason, Alex, and my philosophy is going to be I don't want my pitcher going a third time through the order. They took Tanaka out after 68 pitches in one of the playoff games. Why am I spending all this money giving 7-8 years to a pitcher that I'm basically going to treat as like any other starting pitcher? Does the philosophy take them out of going after big-time pitchers and giving big-time money when they're so reliant on the bullpen?
So, Don, here's where that doesn't work. When you have a regular season, you have the luxury of the 10-day IL. You have the luxury of playing with a 40-man roster. When you lock in on October 1st, you're locked into 25 players. Generally speaking, starters are starters because they're better than bullpen. I think it's nonsense that a starter can't face a lineup for the third time, but what happens in a short series, and you saw it with Houston, you have these secondary and tertiary pitchers that are bullpen that you're facing them for the third and fourth time in a short series. To me, that's worse. And you saw what they did with Harris. They abused him late. He was dominant early. But you're facing the guy for the third time in the lineup, not in one game, but in the course of seven games. That's even a bigger liability than having Paxton and Tanaka face someone for the third time.
All right. Now, Alex is going to be on the Tonight Show tomorrow with Jimmy Fallon.
Oh, wow.
He's got the meet and greet we're giving away for the sneakers. And I got to tell you, Alex, I've worn them. I've gotten compliments on them. And Don and Peter are furious that they don't have a pair.
It's not right, Alex.
Now, the furious is not the word
it's
I would use.
Hurt is the word. What size are you?
I'm a 10.5, Don. What are you?
10.5, 11.
Oh, yeah. But, Alex, they look fantastic.
They're on their way. They will be there this week.
Wow. They're handcrafted in Portugal, for God's sake. And if you want to get them, almamaterfootwear.com. You can get them on presale right now. We will give away another pair of sneakers and tickets to meet A-Rod tomorrow because all the tickets to that are gone.
It's amazing. Also, the sneakers are sold out, I'm told, too.
Oh, the sneakers are gone now.
Yeah.
Oh.
Got to have another printing, Alex.
Michael, I need you to be my agent.
I think you have enough work. CNBC back in the game. These are emotional stories, Alex. You're a guy who took care of your money from the very beginning. When you deal with a Holyfield and tonight with a Lochte, is there a pity factor to it that, wow, how could you let this all get away?
So, Michael, let me start again. So I learned by mistakes. I had the great fortune to play for almost 25 years. And I was one of the luckiest human beings that got paid for such a long time, to a degree overpaid for most of my career. When you think average career is 5.5 years, and an athlete makes 90% of their lifetime income from age 20 to 30, we have 750 players, 750, less than 5% have a college degree. So with that information alone, I'm not an investment banker, but I was short that stock, that players, athletes and entertainers will run into trouble. When you see the case of Evander Holyfield, a true icon, someone that I looked up to, my brother looked up to, he doesn't have one enemy in the street. This guy's one of the most likable, genuine guys, came from Alabama, single mother, you know, 9 siblings, and he makes $260 million and is in this position. A is because they're not surrounding themselves with the right people, they don't have the right representation, and they don't have an alignment that's aligned to help them in the long run. It's really, really sad.
Well, tonight, 10 p.m. on CNBC, A-Rod's TV show, Back in the Game. Alex, thanks so much. Good luck with the sneakers and everything that's going on.
Thank you, guys, and I'll be sending those sneakers over as soon as I can.
All right. You don't have to.
I'm waiting.
That's very nice.
Take it easy, Alex.
Bye now.